Hi, my name is Noopur and I work at Nilenso as a designer. Today I will be talking about things that I wish I knew as a newbie designer. Something that's been very close to me and something that I've gotten a bit of perspective on as I have progressed into my work life. So, yeah. So, going back into college days, which is where this picture is from, and you can see me there. And this is from a small assignment that we did as a part of our exercise. This was from color theory, and we were studying universal design and color theory. So while studying this, one of our teachers gave us a small lecture, and after the lecture got over, they gave us this B4 size sheet and a bunch of colors to create a color palette. And for creating the color palette, the kind of requirements that were given, or the brief that was given, was that just create a palette. It doesn't have to make feel like anything, or it doesn't have to give certain kind of it wasn't specific to a product or anything like that. So we were left pretty much open about how do we go about making this palette. And we had to use three colors. So this is what we ended up making. And this was after the end of the lecture where we were standing. There was an interesting observation which was made right after this picture, which was that the colors that all of us had used in our palettes were either the colors that we were wearing or the colors that anyone else in the room was wearing. We were sitting in a white room and there was nothing around, and we had all the time and absolutely no restrictions about what kind of a palette we had to make, but we still ended up picking colors which was just around us. So there was one takeaway from this incident, and which is why I also have come back to it a lot, is that we are affected by what our surroundings are and our personalities and our surroundings. They get into our work, and that happens very unconsciously. So today I will be taking you through the journey of me from my design school time to where I am now. And the steps through this journey would be sort of talking about who is a newbie designer, the mental model that a newbie designer comes with when they enter the industry. Then we will be talking about a couple of experiences and stories that I've had while I was doing the work, and a couple of takeaways for us that we might just be able to relate to. So, who is a newbie? A newbie can be a person who's new into the design field, fresh out of college. They have spent time trying to polish their skills, learning design concepts with faculty and their peers as guide. And it could also be someone who's tried to get into this new domain. So they have looked up things on the internet, they have tried to follow up good designers and tried to work their way through things. And they have taken feedback from only specific people whom they know, and that's how they proceed. So, interesting thing is, how do they actually feel when they enter the industry? They kind of feel like Calvin. They go a little existential at one point, but just to look at somewhat real points, yeah, they are really passionate people. They are very passionate about the domain that they have gotten in. They have figured out some specific reason why they like the work that they're doing, and they're very willing to learn because of this. They have their own process. So while doing the work that they're trying to learn and while trying to polish their skills, they figure out a process of their own, which they know will take them forward while they are also working. So the process is something that is very close to them, and that is something they know they will be using, and that's the something they come from as they enter the industry. They care about users. So again, the work that we do is very close to users. You need to empathize with the users. You need to think about what are the you need to think out of the preconceived notions that people have when you do design. So they have to try to step into the user's shoes and try to think about different kind of solutions that might just work for a user. They are thinkers. So like anyone in a creative industry where people do a lot of thinking, they are also thinkers. They need to switch into different roles since they don't have real people around in terms of clients and stuff. So they need to do a lot of thinking. And because of that, they are quite close to thinking by themselves. So they are the one who are thinking and they're alone in that. They want to improve. So all the time that they spend learning design skills and other aspects of design, they know that they want to get better at things. They know when they enter the industry, they also feel like they should be able to implement these things. So, and the way they're implementing these things is also how they're going to learn eventually. And there's no way to learn design apart from the thing that you're actually doing it. And they're scared and maybe a little intimidated as well, because, you know, we all enter the industry with this notion that, okay, things will be like this, but you are with new people and they don't understand you and you don't understand them and you're just scared. And there are people who are fairly experienced in the industry and, you know, you have looked up to them while you're doing the work, and for all you know, you don't want to end up looking like a fool in front of them. So yeah, you are intimidated. So there's another thing that comes up while you're in the industry is the kind of new people that you end up working with, which is business owners and other stakeholders. This is the aspect that you're not easily able to touch upon while you're learning design. And this is the place where you are able to see. And these are the people whom they know will help them make better designs. So they are definitely looking up for that. Another group of people that comes to them is peers and other team members. These peers can be designers, they can be developers, they can be QA people who are experts in their own domain. So they have a lot of things, and trying to get to the details of those new domains that they had never even thought about. So now I will be talking about a couple of stories which will be pretty much personal experiences. And the reason that a lot of these stories and experiences make sense is because in hindsight. So I can actually start talking to you about first story, which is when I was told that you're not doing any work. And so this was one of the first projects that I started with, and the client was super interesting. They had met us, and in a couple of hours we were on board on the project. I was taking to the client place in a day, and we got requirements. And it was a startup, so, and they had not done anything before till then. So we had to make our own requirements. So we sat down with the team. We tried to figure out more and more details about the project. And at a point, I think at the end of the discussion, we had good enough content for us to take back to our offices and start working on things. There were also other people in the team. There were two more designers in the team that I was working with, which was great because you know those people and you know that they're, so you have some sense of mentorship also in that sense. And that was great for me. And one of the things that I was looking forward to in this particular project was that, you know, this is like this perfect opportunity for me to be able to showcase my skills. And so what really happened? So after going back, we started working. I picked up one task, made a lot of variations, made a lot of different kind of things because I also want to show my skill, and took feedback. So gave it to the, shared it with the client, got good feedback from them. Eventually also started iterating on things. And as I got a good enough idea of what the final design might look like, we had a I ended up sharing with the client, and I picked up new tasks. So while all this was going on, 2-3 weeks down the line, I was called in a separate room with a couple of my colleagues, and they told me that, you know, the client feels that you're not actually doing any work. And that was a bit of a shock. Like, I was taken aback. I didn't realize what's going on. And there were a couple of other thoughts going on in my head. I was wondering as to, like, I was being accused of doing my own job. That's the thing that I'm hired for, and they're saying that I'm not doing any work. Then another thought that came to my head was that maybe I'm just being compared. So, you know, there are so many people in the team, and they're more experienced. They definitely have a lot of knowledge that they come with. So, yeah, maybe I'm not able to match to them. So, yeah, I'm being compared. Or maybe I just sucked as a designer. So this was like hitting the rock bottom, thinking that, okay, you are terrible as a person. Another bad thought that came to my head while doing this was, say, maybe they just don't like me. So I'm sort of a different personality. I don't talk too much. I am quiet. I don't make jokes like every other person in the team who try to maybe make the situation better by making jokes and laughing. And I don't do that. So maybe they just don't like me. And while all this was going on, there were parts that I was realizing that, okay, I know that I've made mistakes. They have been told to me as well. And the thing is that I accept those mistakes, but the last thing anyone should be saying to me right now is that I'm not doing any work because the work is pretty much out there. So what was actually happening? And this project got over, we moved on. I think I spent each and every day or each and every hour of my time after the project to figure out what was going on. And it didn't seem very clear to me till I was very much distant from the problem itself. So to look at things from the other side, what I was doing was I wasn't sharing ideas. So while I was working on concepts, while I was making different variations for the product, I wasn't actually sharing it with the client and even with the team. Till the time I was able to come to a final outcome, I didn't actually share it with them. And they felt that maybe they're not a part of the process in that sense. So yeah, it kept hitting me like that. I looked like a black box. So while I was working on these designs, I never actually ended up communicating enough about them. I didn't tell people what stage I was in. Even if I don't make a lot of progress, if I'm doing a lot of research, I didn't actually end up sharing with them. And because of that, I ended up looking like a black box. I accepted feedback with an okay. So while you get feedback on designs, or while you were getting any feedback or about how you were working on things, I accepted feedback and said, okay, this is, I know, something that I need to work upon. And I just left it there. I didn't tell that why I feel that I need to work on this. I didn't tell how am I going to improve and how and when I come back and tell them that, okay, this thing is actually done. I didn't communicate delays. So since I was already stuck in the loop of making a lot of variations, trying to do different type of work, and the design was progressing in my head, and I didn't call out the delays in the project. And the last thing, which is probably one of the most important things, is I didn't close things. So while you're doing work, after one task got over, I took up new things. I didn't make sure that the thing that I closed was in a state that someone else can actually take it up and start implementing them, or confirm with the client that, okay, this design doesn't need any more work and someone can take it up from here. So I didn't do any of those things. And now that I look back, all these things are pretty evident that, yeah, it might just have looked to a business person that, you know, I'm not doing any work. So takeaway from this is that design collaboration is really, really hard. It's not an easy job. It's not something that even people after a couple of years in their life are able to try to solve. So communicating more is the thing that you need to do here. Communicating as much as you can possibly do, telling people small aspects of things, talking about the nuances that you come across, because that is what will probably take you closer to having some collaboration. Another story that I can talk about right now is when I was told that I was not accepting any feedback. So this was an interesting thing because after the project got over, the work went very well. And after the project, we were sitting and having a small discussion with the clients. And they started talking about what went well and what is something that I probably need to work upon. And in the discussion, they gave like three kinds of feedback, which was sort of more constructive and something that I had to work upon. First type was in which they gave their perception of things, saying that, you know, you did this, and we don't really feel that, okay, you were trying to make effort here. And I didn't exactly get what they meant there, so I asked them more questions about it. The second one that they spoke about was telling me things that I know that I needed to work upon, so I accepted it. I said that, yeah, you know, I'm not communicating enough. And I said that, yeah, I know that I'm not good at it, and I know I need to work upon it, and I left it there. And the third kind was where I got some pretty strong statements, and those were mainly based upon something maybe that I said or something that I did, and they were kind of terrifying because, you know, you don't see yourself as that sort of a person. So my reaction to that was pretty much emotional. I either turned into a shell or I reacted a bit maybe emotionally. And the discussion, which started in a very good note, ended up becoming something completely different. And while this was going on, someone just said that, okay, you don't really know how to take feedback. And I was thinking that, wait, you know, I want to know what I did wrong. I want to know, I want to improve, I want to understand exactly what was happening. Then I accepted my mistakes. I accept that, you know, I'm not the perfect person. So you need to help me to improve. And the things which were strong, they were hitting me back and back, saying that, you know, wait, I can't really be this person. And another thing that was there was that, you know, I'm sitting here and listening to you. I'm actually asking you more questions. So why do you feel that I'm not listening? So again, these things didn't make sense at that point. Looking back, thinking from their perspective, couple of months down the line, is when I probably got to a point where I had some clarity on what happened in that one small 30 minutes meeting. So I ended up looking defensive when I asked people questions. Maybe they were not formed in the right sense. Maybe that was not the right time to ask those questions. Maybe they wanted me to go back home and absorb the feedback and then come back asking more details about it. But since my reaction was right away, they felt like, okay, I'm actually not listening, and maybe I'm just being defensive at this place. They had another worse understanding of things, which is I ended up looking a person who's sort of having superficial understanding. So when I said that, okay, I accept this, they might have thought that, you know, this person doesn't really realize why is communication important. And when I say that I accept it, I didn't tell them why is it important to me and how am I already trying. So they could have realized that this person is making effort into trying to make things work for us, but they didn't really come across, and I didn't come across clear about that point. And the worst was, say, reacting emotionally. So yeah, reacting emotionally was something that we can do very easily when someone says something to us, and it was feedback, and I think they didn't mean it in a sense that, okay, you know, you did this wrong, so you need to improve on it. But yeah, I realized that later on that, okay, this is something I need to sort of control and try to improve on these aspects. So the learning from here mainly was to discuss feedback. I think even whatever clarity I got about this was discussing it more and more with my peers and discussing it more and more even in my head, that, you know, what actually happened. And that's when you get to the actual facets of things. That's when you realize small things that might just trigger emotional response in someone else, where they end up saying that, okay, you know, you don't really accept feedback. So that kind of a strong reaction will come if you don't realize what you're saying. So this kind of a feedback, I think all of us are used to, make that rounded rectangle rounder, or similar things like make the logo bigger. Wow factor nahi hai yaar, just, you know, make it shine, maza nahi aa raha hai. Or even like very critical things, saying that make that text in this point size using this typeface and in this particular color. And especially when you're starting out, this kind of feedback can be scary because you know that you're trying to improve and you know that you're working. But when someone says this, gives this kind of feedback, you feel very undervalued. So this story is sort of related to that. So since I had all the previous learnings, I made sure that I'm sharing everything with the client. I made sure that I'm going in a good direction. I kept checking with them over and over again. I got regular feedback and took their inputs, iterated on things, and shared first cut version of things. So I had clarity. And at the end of it, when I was showcasing the designs, I hear such feedback. So what do you really feel when you hear such sort of feedback? Your first reaction is just, why? Like, what is going on? That doesn't make any sense. Why should I do this? This doesn't make any sense. You feel that you're not a tool. You are not sitting there as a designer trying to implement exactly what someone is saying. You are trying to put thought. You have put thought into each and everything that you have done. So why are you giving me feedback like that? And then another negative loop that you will get into is that, you know, did I do something wrong to deserve this? Like, what did I actually do wrong that this is happening to me? So again, how I reacted to this was, interestingly, since all these things are something that you react to eventually, like right away. So one of the things was that I went my way anyway. There were discussions where a lot of times what the client was saying or what someone else was saying was not making a lot of sense, or maybe it felt like they're being very dictatorship, sort of a very dictator person about giving this sort of feedback. So I went my way, and I thought that the kind of changes that they're seeing is going to disturb the design. So I went ahead. Second thing I did was explain and reasoned. I tried to give my version of things. I tried to tell them how I put thought into some things and what they're saying is usable at certain places and why it doesn't work in this context. So I tried to reason those things out. Another type of reaction that I've had in dealing with such experiences is being overwhelmed. So when there is too much back and forth, you know that the design is not progressing, and all you're doing is just having this argument of saying your word against mine, and you realize that, you know, it's a one-way street there. Someone, the people are not listening to you. So you give in, and you eventually make those changes. So things here might just come out to be very different, and it feels like these are the right things to do, but the only right thing to do is actually explaining and trying to reason what you're doing. And the others might make sense in different contexts, but they can come out to be in a very different way. So if you look at things from a business person perspective, you might end up coming out closed. So when you are going your way, you are you just end up looking like this shell who doesn't want to listen to what others are saying. You don't even want to understand. So you end up looking very closed. You don't understand business perspective. So it might just happen that someone who's giving you such strong feedback or such feedback saying that make this green greener or make the box bigger or something like that, they're probably not able to articulate what they want to say. Maybe they have different constraints. Maybe they have business timelines that they're working with because of which they're saying things. So how do you really deal with such situations? One is to not panic, to not react emotionally, because when you react emotionally, you also give space to other people to be able to have their emotional reaction. And if they are a little bit on the top in terms of hierarchy with you, you will not go ahead. Change your perspective. So try to step away from the design. Try to think about why someone else is giving this kind of a suggestion. Try to ask them more questions about why do you think that whatever they're saying is more important. And this will help you sort of come to a common ground, and your design will not suffer. And then pick your battles. So this comic is actually titled Duty Calls. And really, it doesn't matter if you're right or wrong. It really doesn't matter. You just need to pick your battles. You can ignore a lot of things that sometimes people are saying because they don't actually mean those things. So the takeaway from here is that stakeholders' perspectives are really, really important. They make you realize the other side of things which you are normally not aware of, and they they take you a long way in terms of learning how product works and how design works and the place of design in different places. So this last story is actually quite close to me, and this is thinking about all the different learnings that you've had again, right? So you know that you need to communicate, you know that you should be taking feedback, you know how to react to certain kind of design feedback, and then you're at a place where you have taken up a design which is sort of a big task. It has, say, bigger timelines, and you realize that, okay, you know, this design needs more thought and it needs more time as compared to the timelines that we're working with. Then you don't feel very motivated because you know it's not going in the right direction, and there are a lot of aspects that are bothering you about it. So you're getting blocked on ideas, you're not able to proceed, and there might just be other things that maybe there are personal things that are bothering you, and overall you're not able to work. And this has happened in the past, and this happens to, I think, all of us at any point in time, that we get blocked. So how does it look to the other side, right? Like, it looks like, okay, you're not working iteratively, you are not meeting deadlines because you're obviously stuck on ideas, you're obviously not able to get out of whatever emotional state you're in, and you look like a black box. So now we're back to square one, that you know all these learnings that you've had in the past, how are they actually helping you? So thinking about all these things, that okay, design collaboration and knowing these aspects, is all that enough? And the more I think about it, I've read books, I've discussed things with people, tried to get more and more feedback, and it doesn't sink in. Sometimes it doesn't sink in. So how do you actually make things work? Because when you're actually in these situations, you're not able to react. You're not able to react sensibly, and maybe an hour later you'll realize, wait, I should not have done that. So cut yourself some slack. Take a break. Cut yourself some slack. You, like every other person, needs a break. Try to communicate about this, that, okay, you know, this is blocking me out too much, and I am not in a state to be able to work on this. So now that we know all these processes exist and these are the important aspects of things, there are a couple of processes that I can talk about which have helped me and which I've been able to figure out with my team to be able to get things forward and to be able to react to things in a nicer manner. And even when you're in shit, you're in bad situations, you will be able to work. So one is using progress tracking tools. So while you're working very closely with the product, with the users, and you're thinking a lot on the design aspect, you somehow end up not realizing kind of progress you're making. And we have used, say, time tracking tools. We have used even project management tools for that matter. Using something like Trello also works. But even a simple thing like making lists. So make a list of things that you want to do. Write like 10 things that you know that you need to do in the day. And this list will be very useful. Say, if, for example, you have stand-ups, you can reprioritize them based on, you know, what is the things that you need to get done like today itself. Another thing that helps is doing design showcases. So so in longer projects, in bigger projects where the timelines are very shrink and, you know, the person you're probably reporting to is dealing with more than one aspect than the other, then you don't really realize how, at what place will they be able to observe your progress, or will or what place they'll be able to observe your work. So visibility is what design showcases will get you. And we have tried to do it every bi-weekly or even weekly if needed. And this makes sure that other people realize that, okay, you know that you are doing work. And yeah, even if they're not able to attend these meetings, they know that you'll probably end up sending up an email, or you are doing it religiously no matter what. Then structured feedback. Having more drill down process about how you're getting feedback will make sure that we don't end up getting the kind of vague feedback a lot of times end up coming to us. So say doing feedback sessions in a manner where you have almost all the business people talking about what they like and what they don't like about designs. And since everyone's individual opinion is about both the good and the bad, you can discuss them objectively, and then you will be able to come to a good point where you have good designs and even people agreeing upon what the final solution is. Doing estimations. So we have started doing estimations based on the agile process, trying to understand the problem, trying to break it down into smaller chunks to see that we don't miss out on any aspects. And these things are important, but another important aspect of estimation is that you also realize that business priorities are existing and they affect how the product will proceed. And since they are involved in these estimations, they will help you prioritize, and you know that you're on the same page as them. Then having retrospectives. So after almost every long project that we have had, we've made sure that we look back. We look back trying to discuss what went well, what compromises we made that we don't want to make in the future, what things didn't go too well, and we discuss them based on what feels most important. And the interesting thing is that we have gotten into the detail of like even conversations that, you know, this is something that might just have triggered the emotional reaction or some reaction throughout the next project or throughout the project that you were working on. So those specific reasons, they help you. Those specific incidents, they'll help you getting out of the block that you might just be having while when you take up new projects. So looking back, we know that design collaboration is hard, so just communicate more as much as possible. To discuss design feedback, because the more you discuss design feedback, the better you also can convey to the other client or the other person that you are actually listening. And the fact that you're both on the same page is very important. Stakeholder perspectives are important, that you need to incorporate that. You need to know that these are real things. You can't keep working in those situations where you feel that, okay, like you want to finish this design in 30 days, but what you really have is maybe 3 days. So there are design, there are stakeholders' perspective which are really important for certain things. And then cut yourself some slack. Figure out what you really need. Talk to people about it. If you need a break, take a break. If you think that you're not able to take up a task, then tell someone in your team that, okay, you know, maybe you can ask someone else to share that responsibility with you. Because if you're working in this mental model, then you wouldn't be able to proceed and you'll end up looking like a, you know, terrible designer. So this is how, whatever I've been trying to say, that how well we communicate is not actually determined by how well we say things, but how well are we understood. And this is kind of the crux of how design in the industry finds their place, and that's kind of where we are. So I would like to say thank you for being such a patient audience after dinner and questions.
It was really nice. It's kind of introspect you what you did. Mm-hmm. But I want to hear the other side of the story. You already mentioned few things. Mm-hmm. But can you tell like your seniors or your guide how they helped you to mm-hmm. come up this stage?
So after, say, getting such strong feedback from people, right? One of the things that helped me a lot was actually communicating with the people who were there as a part of my team. So discussing with them, realizing that since it's such a strong feedback and you realize the impact of it, you also feel bad. And the best thing that they did was to tell me that, you know, don't feel bad. It's fine. Everyone goes through this. And they shared their experiences. They told me that, you know, when I started out, I also did these things. And that also helped me open up. And eventually, I was able to share things with them at every level, discussing small aspects, say. Then you get to situations, right? So when you're comfortable, then you start discussing things in detail and understanding that, you know, you're not always talking in your head. There's someone else listening to you. Realizing small things like that was by a lot of conversations and a lot of very strong feedback. So my first year, I think, at the company was just getting really, really strong feedback. And I would just sit and listen that, okay, you know, what is going on? And so, yeah, those, that kind of feedback, that close reviews that we have, that is what has helped us. And we have a very strong review process at our company. So, yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, hi, it was... Hello. Hello. Yeah, it was a nice talk.
Thank
so, basically what happens, this said that first image is the last image what you make. So,
sorry?
Whatever is your first image,
uh-huh,
does matters. So, in this kind of situation, particularly some will make a predefined image of yours, that this particular person is in this way.
Yeah.
So, how would you act in this way so that that image of that particular person which has made of yours, you would like to change it?
So, I think... the only way that the image can be changed is by working with people. And if someone is making a first image of you, I think it's a little, it's obvious that they will make a first image of you. And I know that it can be very unforgiving sometimes. And this is something that has come up to me a lot. But I think it's okay. I think it's fine that we, like I as a person feel that if I'm not able to learn and if I'm not able to proceed, it's kind of blocking, and people will have perceptions, people will have images, but the more you work with them, the more you realize that, the more they will also realize that, you know, you are not the same person anymore. Even having, say, normal discussions with them, and say, if they had an image of you, you can go back and talk about it to them. Just try to understand that, you know, now I realize that something that you said at that point made a lot of sense, and I have actually done this to a lot of people. I have done it with my previous clients that I said, okay, you know, this thing you said that time, yeah, I realize the importance of it now. And thank you so much for saying that. And that, yeah, that changes your image a little. They realize that you're actually listening, and that helps. So, yeah. Thank you.
Hi, Noopur.
Hi.
I could relate to many of the experiences that you've shared because I might have gone through the same things. So here's one question to you.
Yeah.
Say today or tomorrow, you become a design manager and you have an intern or a newbie designer working under you and who probably isn't performing to the best of his potential.
Yeah.
So how long would you wait or how long would you give that person before you give such a strong feedback? Or would you take a different approach altogether?
So yeah, that actually is a very good question. And so... there's one thing that we have tried to do is talk to people about as much as expectations that you're having and in what kind of time you're maybe looking at them to improve. And if you think about how much are you willing to wait for some person to improve, I think that timeline can be infinite. You know that there are certain things that you would want immediate improvement on. There's some things that you know would not come overnight. So learning communication wouldn't come overnight. You know that one day, you know, someone will wake up and tell you that, okay, you've not become better at it. So it actually happened with me that one of my mentors, while I knew that I'm not communicating very well, this one day he just came up to me and said, oh man, you've improved on your communication a lot. I just loved the way you gave stand-ups today. You were so articulate about everything you said. And I was surprised. I'm like, huh, did I? And they said, yeah, you've improved. And I just realized at that moment that I had improved. And yeah, so it will happen very consciously. And I think you can try to set sort of realistic timelines. So know what is important to you, know for which things are you open to spending a bit more time on, and looking at it from even their perspective, right? So it's difficult to be able to understand the importance of these things when you come up from a different mental model and from a very different background. So yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Noopur.
Yeah. Thank you.
If you have any more questions, please take it to her off stage.